Now, here we are in the Olivia O'Keeffe Gallery here in Houghton, and I have a very special guest here with me today, Joe Bowe. And behind us is a selection of his amazing work, and we're going to have a little talk on why he paints, what he paints, and now. Welcome, Joe.
Thank you, good to be here.
Great. Maybe we can start at when you started painting.
Well, I'm 32 now, so I started when I was 16, and my story is that I ended up in a psychiatry. I was diagnosed with a mental illness called manic depression, also known as bipolar disorder. One of the programs while I was in the psychiatry was called creative therapy, as well as, you know, fitness, things like that. So I came into contact with painting, you know, loads of paint and the canvas and certain objects during my hospitalization when I was 16. So that's how it started for me.
Wow.
And I never stopped.
So
that's about half my life ago.
Yeah.
So I'm 32 now.
Yeah.
I started when I was 16, 16 times two.
Wow. And I know you're extremely productive. Where are you positioned now? Do you have a studio?
Yeah, I actually work in two different locations at the moment. I work in a place called Nieuwegein, where I have an apartment studio, where I live and work. And I also have four cells that I rent in an old police station called Gunsthuis. And that's not too far away from here. So I work in Nieuwegein and in Houten, which is about, you know, for me, it's like half an hour on the bike.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm constantly moving from
one location.
Working in Houten, working in Nieuwegein. And it's a nice balance. Instead of just having one location, I like that I have two different locations. Actually, I also noticed that I tend to make different things.
Okay.
Because it's a different environment.
Okay, and then maybe also practically with where you spray.
Exactly,
or,
as well,
okay.
Yeah, because my studio, the cells,
mm-hmm.
Here in Houten, is, you know, I don't live there.
Yeah.
So I can just make a mess, doesn't matter. Not that my apartment studio is not a mess, but it's just, you know, I live there, so I kind of got to think of my hygiene,
and
it's got to be tidy sometimes.
Yeah, you want to be able to function otherwise.
Yeah, so it's different.
Yeah.
So I tend to make more oil paintings, for example, here in Houten.
Yeah.
A lot more spray paint in Houten. And I work on a lot of acrylic paintings in Nieuwegein, where I live.
Yeah. Yeah. And can you tell me a little bit about your process? Do you start with an idea or materials?
I've always got something to work with because I have my thoughts, I have my emotions, the energy on the inside, my inner world. It depends what kind of a painting I'm working on. If I'm just painting an abstract painting, it's just pure colour and I listen to my intuition. It's just natural. I might work with an idea, so it might be a conceptual piece of art where I'm trying to communicate a certain concept. I work with my emotions, really, and my intuition
and
certain ideas as well.
You like to gather
mostly emotion. Yeah.
I know you like to gather materials to work from as a
As you can see,
an example.
Some pencils, some tulips, an old mobile phone, some toy cars. So I collect certain objects.
Mm-hmm.
I might find certain objects. I might purchase certain objects or order certain objects online that I use in my art. So it's not just paint,
mm-hmm.
it's also, it kind of developed into what I call canvas sculpture,
okay.
Which is just, you know, which is using the canvas as the foundation.
Yep.
And I use certain objects like slicing pencils through the canvas or cars and door handles.
Amazing. When is a painting for you successful? Could you tell me?
I think if it makes an impact on me, if it makes a strong impact on my mind, that's the only way that I can really tell whether it's any good, because otherwise it would just be pointless, I think.
Yeah. So number one, it has to resonate with you.
Yeah, and then I want to share that impact with other people. But how I kind of know when it's finished is just listening to my intuition.
Mm-hmm.
If I look at a piece of art and I think, I know, it doesn't quite feel right, then it's not finished. But if I think, okay, cool, it's done, don't do anything to it, nice one, and then we move on to the next.
Okay.
So it's an intuition thing, it's a feeling. I kind of base my decision on my intuition.
Okay, very good. Yeah. Now, just check my list here. What does leading a creative life mean for you?
It really appeals to me because I can, use my thoughts, my emotions in a very fun, very creative way, and that's quite a relief because I wouldn't really know what else to do with my thoughts, my emotions, my energy on the inside.
So it's
very rewarding to work with my thoughts and my emotions and
is it like you're able to channel them and use that as source.
Yeah, because that's what I'm working with. You know, I'm working with my emotion, my thoughts. So what does it mean for me to, you said, what does it mean to lead
a creative life? Yeah.
I think it makes me feel very free.
Okay, great.
It's very, I feel, when I'm working on my art, that's when I feel free. Like the creative process, for me, is just,
it's like riding the wave, maybe, or
I'm in the zone.
It's just
pure freedom.
Yeah.
You know, that's how I feel in the moment while I'm expressing myself.
And about being in the zone, like when you're like when the inspiration is flowing, do you have ways of getting in the zone, or do you just work through it, or how does that work for you?
By drinking tea.
Great. It's always a part of it.
No, I think I kind of feel I'm always in the zone.
Mm.
I always feel like I've you know, I get up and I go to bed still in the zone.
Brilliant.
I'm always thinking, I'm always feeling, I think everyone is.
Mm-hmm.
So I've always got something to work with and I'm always inspired. I think life is a very inspiring thing to be alive. And I'm never thinking, you know, what should I work on? What's my next idea? Oh no, I've run out of ideas.
Mm, or never happens.
No, that doesn't happen because I've got so much emotion inside of me, so much energy on the inside that I need to express. It needs to flow out of me, and then you know these kind of paintings come about and. Yeah, so I kind of feel like I'm always in the zone. I like to put on some music, you know, that helps, a cup of tea. As long as I've got some materials available to me and some space, I can always, create.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
How would you describe your art?
Well, I have very diverse collection of art. As you can see, you know, I've got some abstract pieces of art, but also got some some...
more sculpture.
Yeah, sort of canvas sculpture. But...
And more conceptual ones.
Yeah. And also, use language. But how I would describe my art would be... there's two main parts, really. It's the paintings where I just use paint, mostly, just you know, canvas and paint. And then I have the canvas sculpture.
Mm.
So those are the two main different types of paintings that I make. And it's very emotional, I think. It's 3D, 2D. I like to use certain objects that have meaning to us as a human race. If I see something on the street and I feel like, hey, this has meaning to me, or this has meaning to society or whatever, I'll pick it up.
Okay.
So I find a lot of objects, I collect a lot of objects, and I buy a lot of objects.
Yeah.
And the whole process of doing that, of accumulating things, bits and bobs, and objects, and physical things, it's quite exciting.
It sounds very organic, isn't it? Kind of on your daily route, you never know what you might come across, and could take maybe a few years before you actually use it for something?
Actually, recently, cleaned up, well, organized my studio in the cells near here, and I found like so many different objects that I collected like 5 years ago that I just completely forgot about. So that's quite exciting to find old objects that I collected or found 5 years, maybe even 10 years ago. And
do you have popular themes that are reoccurring in your
work? Well, I have a lot to say about mental illness. I have a lot to say about substance abuse. So I like to communicate a lot of certain things within those topics.
Mm-hmm.
But I also like the 2D kind of paintings.
Yeah.
I like to paint a lot of entities, I call them, like separate living organisms in the nature under the sun.
Oh.
So I've done a lot of, you know, when it comes to 2D, recently I've done a lot of animals and people, but I don't really call them animals and people,
mm-hmm.
I call them more entities.
Yeah.
Like, but you could say they're people, but...
is there an example in this one?
Yeah, like these ones. Dark entities dancing in the sunlight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could see them as human beings, but they're not really, are not painted
they're
human
not
beings.
So literally
they're
entities. Suggestive of
separate
human
living
forms.
Yeah, just certain figures.
Yeah.
I didn't necessarily paint three dark human beings dancing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's
does it kind of evolve, or you see later all that reminds you of, or?
I just think there are there are more living creatures than just humans.
Yeah.
So they're not necessarily
one type.
Like you and me.
Yeah.
You know, there are also a lot of different living organisms around. So.
Could take any form.
Yeah, just different physical form, really. I got here the anxious yellow clown.
Yeah.
Curious boy. I like when it comes to 2D, I do really think it's meaningful to paint figures.
Mm-hmm.
So whether it's these dark entities or a yellow clown or a boy or a crowd of people, I like to, when it comes to 2D, I really like to paint figures because we can relate
to
what we're looking at. If
more
I just
story behind it or is the viewer more curious?
Yeah, and I think a lot of people want to look at a piece of art and recognize something. Mm-hmm. And if I'm creating a figure in a way, it might seem like the viewer is looking into the mirror or into some kind of a reflection when they look at the paintings. They can relate to these dark figures, these dark entities, whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. They can see, all right, yeah, that's three figures, or all right, that's a head over there. You know, I think opposed to this one here, this is just an abstract painting, which is just pure emotion, really, via the color. It's just very different. A lot of people wouldn't understand that because it's just, what is it? You know, it's just pure color.
Some people too abstract. Or,
so I think I want to, I like to.
Connecting with
give something viewer. Give something that people can recognize, mm-hmm. something that people can relate to, maybe not always, but that is one of my main themes at the moment, where I'm just painting certain figures in the nature under the sun.
Mm-hmm. Is there a particular emotion or reaction you would like people to have with your work, or is that difficult to say?
I think like I was saying before, it has to make some kind of an intense impact on me, and then I want to share that with the world. So different paintings are going to affect people in different ways, emotionally, mentally. But you know, I really want to make a big impact on people's minds, because if it didn't, it would be pointless. So I don't necessarily want to disturb people. I wouldn't want people to look at a piece of art of mine and not feel good.
Mm-hmm.
But that happens.
Yeah.
Because I also discuss, you know, not very nice things. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, I want it to have some kind of an impact on the viewer's mind.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it would be pointless.
Some kind of trigger.
Some kind of a
reaction.
Yeah, internally.
Yeah. No, I think we've covered quite a lot of ground right now. I'm looking forward to shortly looking at your paintings in more depth. I think we'll leave it there for today, and we'll be coming back with part two, looking at Joe Bowe's work in detail.